Let all these things be done with the utmost secrecy. Mind, the most impenetrable secrecy. Yes, sir. Report to me promptly at the usual hour. Yes, sir. Go. Yes, sir. He was gone. Inspector Blunt was silent and thoughtful a moment, while the fire in his eyes cooled down and faded out. Then he turned to me and said in a placid voice, I am not given to boasting. It is not my habit. But we shall find the elephant. I shook him warmly by the hand and thanked him, and I felt my thanks, too. The more I had seen the man, the more I liked him, and the more I admired him and marveled over the mysterious wonders of his profession. Then we parted for the night, and I went home with a far happier heart than I had carried with me to his office. Next morning, it was all in the newspapers, in the minutest detail. It even had editions, consisting of Detective This, Detective That, and Detective The Other's theory as to how the robbery was done, who the robbers were, and whether they had flown with their booty. There were 11 of these theories, and they covered all the possibilities. And this single fact shows what independent thinkers detectives are. No two theories were alike, or even much resembled each other, save in one strike in particular. And in that one, all the other 11 theorists were absolutely agreed. That was that although the rear of my building was torn out and the only door remained locked, the elephant had not been removed through the rent, but by some other undiscovered outlet. All agreed that the robbers had made that rent only to mislead the detectives. That never would have occurred to me, or to any other layman perhaps, but it had not deceived the detectives for a moment. Thus, what I had supposed was the only thing that had no mystery about it was in fact the very thing I had gone farthest astray in. The 11 theories all named the supposed robbers, but no two named the same robbers. The total number of suspected persons was 37. The various newspaper accounts all closed with the most important opinion of all, that of Chief Inspector Blunt. A portion of this statement read as follows. The chief knows who the two principals are, namely Brick Daffy and Red McFadden. 10 days before the robbery was achieved, he was already aware that it was to be attempted, and had quietly proceeded to shadow these two noted villains. But unfortunately, on the night in question, their track was lost, and before it could be found again, the bird was flown, that is, the elephant. Daffy and McFadden are the boldest scoundrels in the profession. The chief had reasons for believing that they are the men who stole the stove out of the detective headquarters on a bitter night last winter, in consequence of which the chief and every detective present were in the hands of the physicians before morning, some with frozen feet, others with frozen fingers, ears, and other members. When I read the first half of that, I was more astonished than ever at the wonderful sagacity of this strange man. He not only saw everything in the present with a clear eye, but even the future could not be hidden from him. I was soon at his office and said I could not help wishing he had had those men arrested and so prevented the trouble and loss. But his reply was simple and unanswerable. It is not our province to prevent crime, but to punish it. We cannot punish it until it is committed. I remarked that the secrecy with which we had begun had been marred by the newspapers. Not only all our facts, but all our plans and purposes had been revealed. Even all the suspected persons had been named. These would doubtless disguise themselves now, or go into hiding. Let them. They will find that when I am ready for them, my hand will descend upon them in their secret places as unerringly as the hand of fate. As to the newspapers, we must keep in with them. Fame, reputation, constant public mention. These are the detective's bread and butter. He must publish his facts, else he will be supposed to have none. He must publish his theory, for nothing is so strange or striking as a detective's theory, or brings him so much wonderful respect. We must publish our plans, for these the journals insist upon having, and we could not deny them without offending. We must constantly show the public what we are doing, or they will believe we are doing nothing. It is much pleasanter to have a newspaper say, Inspector Blunt's ingenious and extraordinary theories is as follows, than to have it say some harsh thing, or worse still, some sarcastic one. I see the force of what you say, but I noticed that in one part of your remarks in the paper this morning, you refused to reveal your opinion upon a certain minor point. Yes, we always do that. It has a good effect. Besides, I had not formed any opinion on that point anyway. I deposited a considerable sum of money with the inspector to meet current expenses and sat down to wait for the news. We were expecting the telegrams to begin to arrive at any moment now. Meantime, I reread the newspapers and also our descriptive circular and observed that our $25,000 reward seemed to be offered only to detectives. I said I thought it ought to be offered to anybody who could catch the elephant. The inspector said, "It is the detectives who will find the elephant. Hence, the reward will go to the right place. If other people found the animal, it would only be by watching the detectives and taking advantage of clues and indications stolen from them, and that would entitle the detectives to the reward after all. The proper office of the reward is to stimulate the men who deliver up their time and their trained sagacities to this sort of work, not to confer benefits upon chance citizens who stumble upon a capture without having earned the benefits by their own merits and labors." This was reasonable enough, certainly. Now the telegraph machine in the corner began to click, and the following dispatch was the result. Flower Station, New York, 7:30 a.m. Have got a clue. Found a succession of deep tracks across a farm near here. Followed them for 2 miles east without result. Think elephant went west. Shall now shadow him in that direction. Darley, detective. "Darley's one of the best men on the force," said the inspector. "We shall hear from him again before long." Telegram 2 came. Bakers, New Jersey, 7:40 a.m. Just arrived. Glass factory broken open here during night and 800 bottles taken. Only water in large quantity near here is 5 miles distant. Shall strike for there. Elephant will be thirsty. Bottles were empty. Darley, detective. "That promises well, too," said the inspector. "I told you the creature's appetites would not be bad clues." Telegraph number 3, Taylorville, Louisiana, 8:15 a.m. A haystack near here disappeared during night. Probably eaten. Have got a clue and am off. Hubbard, detective. "How he does move around," said the inspector. "I knew we had a difficult job on hand, but we shall..."